Okay, so at this point, when we run our program, we are going to be asked to submit our username. And then when we submit our username, we connect to the chat. However, notice with this program at this point, when we basically join the room, however, our join room event is not going to essentially is essentially empty, right? So we need to write the functionality of our join room event that would basically take care of our connections. The program that I have so far is functional with the exception of my basic event listeners to join an event, to send public or private messages, and to update the name of the users in the list and the name of the rooms are not associated and created so far. So to go to the next step of this process, I would have to add those five event listeners. So my ElectroServer object needs to be needs to have an event listeners added to it that would look at the message type of join room event, and the function that I will be calling after I set the scope of this listener to this function is going to be on join room event, which is down here. So now that I can minimize the join room function here. So I need to add the join room event to my ElectroServer object. So I'll copy the name of this function into this event listeners. Also, I need to add the functions for public message event, private message event, user list update, and zone update events. Also, so let's just go ahead and create those additional event listeners. So we're going to add another event listener, message type, and this would be a public message event. ES.addEventListener, message type, private, message event, ES.addEventListener, message type, user list update event, and finally add event listener message type zone update event. Okay, now remember the shell for those functions are already created. I'll just go and copy the name of those event handlers into the string. So public message event handler. And then private message event handler. We'll copy that value. And user list update and zone update. So the user list update function that handles that event is called on user list update event, and the function that handles the zone update is called on zone update event. Okay, now I have the event handler functions that will be called when the events of joining a room, sending a private or public message, and updating the list of the users in the user list and the zone updates created. Still, my functionality of the program so far should connect to the server, should allow me to log in. Oh, it says the username exists because I already had this user logged in. So let's log in again, submit, and so now I'm joined in. But at this point, when my user asks the Electro server to log in and to join, the event handlers are now associated, but the join room event is empty, is essentially empty. So see here, the public function join room event is basically empty. So my user gets connected, but to the server, but it doesn't join. He doesn't join a room because I don't have any functionality to resolve or to perform when the server joins or the user join the room. So the functionality for join room event should essentially create and assign the room to my chat room object here, to also display the name of the room there, and to refresh the user list and the zone room list. So what I'm going to do here is that I will have a function for my chat class here called room, an object called room, and I assign to it e.room. So now my user will be at this point entering that room that the Electro server assigns to them. And then the chat room label, which is the label of the window, will use its text value as the e.room.getRoomName. Okay, so now at this point, when the user connects to the server and the login request and response are applied, the server will create a room and joins the user to that room. And so this e.room is the room that the user is being assigned to. So we will basically connect at that point to the room. Let's run this program at this point. And let's submit our username. And as you see here, now the user joined the room lobby. So that chat, the name, is now changed to the lobby. I don't have any additional functionalities for the sending of the messages yet. So so now the room, as you see here, the room name is lobby. So that unjoined room event, when it's called, it enters the user as into the lobby. Notice that the user list and the room list are empty because I haven't refreshed and updated those values. So what I will do here is that I will call my refresh user lists and refresh room list functions. So the functionalities with those two functions, now with the refresh user list and the refresh room list, would basically update the user lists and the name of the rooms. Okay, let's go and find those functions and write those functionalities in. So when the user is logged into the room, I need to go ahead and create the name of all the users that are already in that room. So I create a variable array and I call it users in room. And this is going to be an array. And I read those values from room.get users. So what this does is that it populates the users in room array with the list of all of the users that are already in that room. Then I will create a data provider object. That's a data provider object. Data provider, and then I will loop through the name of all of the users. So I create a loop for I equals 0 to the number of users that I have, users in room dot length plus plus I. Create a user users in room I and then add that value to my data provider. Add item, and the item that we'll be adding is going to be a label. User dot get user name, and the data is going to be user. All right, so this goes through and steps through all of the users in the list and associates and creates a data provider for that, and finally we would update our user list here data provider equals to my data provider. So this step basically creates a local array and gets all of the names of the users in the room and puts it into them, and then creates a data provider and populates that data provider by getting the name of each of those users. So it goes through and steps through all of these users in room item and then takes the users from that list and puts it into this user item and gets the name of the user and gets the pointer or the area in the memory that has that user value in it, and populates that data provider and then puts the data provider back in to the user list. So basically it's essentially refreshing the name of your users in the chat room. So at this point, as you see here, now my users list, which is a list of the users that I created, is going to be updated with the new users. So if I add a new user and connect to the server, so now these two users basically are connected to the program. All right. Now the next step is to go about and refresh our rooms list. That is essentially we wait for the refreshing of the rooms list when we create a new room. Or let's see, is this the point that I want you to see how to do the rooms list? Yeah, let's do the rooms list now as well. So what we'll need to do here is to create a variable, and I call this the zone, which is going to be a variable of the type zone, and I would use it from my Electro server object, get zone manager, get zone by ID, and this would be the zone ID of the room that I'm at. So this process here basically gets the zone ID of the room that I have and gets the zone of that room and puts it into the zone that I need to now use. Now for this, I would now go ahead and create another variable and I call it rooms, which is going to be an array, just like what we did with the user list. And here I read the name of all of the rooms from the zone that I know from up here. So the name of all the rooms are going to populate my my rooms list here. I also have the data provider that I had for my I created for my users list. This is a local variable. And then I will loop through my rooms now, which will basically now go to the rooms.length. And create a local room variable, which is going to be of the type room, and that is going to be the ith room in my rooms variable, and then add that room into my data provider. Add item. And the item would basically now get an object. So the object will have a label, and its label is going to be called local room dot get room name, and its data is going to be local room. And finally, I'll go in my rooms list variable for my class, or my UI essentially, or user interface, and I would add that data provider to my rooms list. There's one last function that I need to write functionalities for, and that is my onZone update event. Well, actually, let's go ahead and write up our onZone update and onUser update events. So for onZone update event, which is the event that's going to be called when anything happens with the zone, like a new room is created or room is deleted, we go ahead and we refresh the room list function. And on user list update event, which is the event that will be happening or will be called when a new user is created or users left the room and joined the room, we will basically call up on refresh users list. All right, so let us run our program. Okay, I have an error here. That's local room. Okay. And we will join two users. Okay, now the users are created and they join the room, and as you see, the lobby room that was created in the zone, each of the users are in the room lobby, and we see that both users are essentially in the list. And so on each user, as you see, the name of the new user is added at the bottom of the list. So Or basically the name of other users in the list are added at the bottom of this list. Okay, so our chat room is basically getting in shape. So next we would like to create the functionality that a user can send a message by clicking on the send message button. So we go ahead and we write the functionality for send public message event and the on private message events. However, before we update these two functionalities, we need to create a mechanism so that when we have the users created, for example, let's say when I have a user here, I need to create a functionality for the send button. And as I showed you earlier, the send button has a event listener that listens to the mouse clicks. So when the mouse clicked, then this should take two functionalities. One is to see whatever message the user has written in the message list here and send that message. To do this, we'll do that essentially by way of parsing whether or not we want the message to be sent to a private user or to use them privately or to be broadcast to the entire users in the list. So we need to take the functionality. The way that this chat room is created, essentially the way that the textbook example is, it looks at the first character of the message. If the first character is a forward slash, then it reads the next series of the characters as a username until you see a colon. And in this case, you would send the message only to this username here. And the rest of your message would be the text of the message that will be sent when you press the send button. If you don't start your message with a forward slash, meaning that if you started with any other character, that message would be sent as a public message. So let's implement this functionality. For this functionality, we go into the event listener that would listen to your mouse click on the send button. Okay, so for this, I'll open up your build UI elements function, and for the button send, you see that there's this on send click button as the event listener for the press of a mouse on send. So we'll have to go and find that function. Let me just minimize the join room, the refresh user list, the refresh rooms list, and on send click. Okay, so this is the body of the function that takes care of sending of our messages. Okay, when the send button is pressed, you would check the length of the message, and remember this message was the text field of the message, and if the message.text.length is zero, that means that the user hasn't typed anything, so nothing should happen. Otherwise, if the length of the message is more than zero, you would get the message to send as a string object from your message field of your class, chat room class. So I would create a variable, and I call this variable message, which would be a string variable. And this would be essentially the value of message.text. All right. Now at this point, we check to see if this message is to be sent public or private. So for doing that, I told you that the message, if it starts with a forward slash, it should be a private message. So you look at your message variable here, and you look at its character at location 0. And if this character is equal to a forward slash, and also your message dot index of the colon in your message is not outside of your message boundary, that means that you created you should create a private message. Otherwise, you will create a public message. Actually, goes right here. All right. So your private, your in the first case, your message is private. Otherwise, a message is your message is public. So in the case of private message, you need to find who the recipient of this message is. So you need to create another variable, and let's call it recipient. And this is going to be a string. And that would be the message function. It's substring that start from location 0 to where your the colon is is placed in your message. So you look at the substring between character 1 all the way to the character before the colon in that message, right? And when you find that, you would basically add that name as the recipient, and the rest of your message will be essentially the rest of your message will be the body of the message. So in this case, instead of creating a new variable, I'll just basically replace my variable by the substring that starts from text of the message. Message.index of where the colon was plus 2. Okay, so at this point, if my message was private, which means that it had a backslash and a colon, I take the name of the recipient, which would be the characters between the backslash and the colon, and the body of the message would be the text that follows colon, actually two spaces after the location of the colon. That way you take the space out. Now next, we need to create the recipient of our message to send to our, essentially to our Electra server. So I create a variable and I call this private recipients. Request. Actually, let's do this. PRMR, standing for private recipient message request. And so we go here and then we create this from the private message request event. And this is going to be a new private message request event. And then PRMR dot set user name usernames is going to be recipients, and then the private recipient message request dot set message will be my message here. And then I will send this private message request to my Electra server. Now, if the message was not to be sent privately, which is a public message, I create the message request object directly. So to do this, you create a public message request, just like we did last week, of the type public message request. equals public message request, and then you populate its value. Public message set message is going to be underscore message dot text, public message request dot set room ID is going to be your room, get room ID, and public message request set zone ID is going to be your room dot get zone ID. And when you're done with that, you go ahead and then you send public message request to your Electro server. Okay, so let's set or test this functionality. Let's run this program. Okay, we have two errors. String here, and add a typo there. Okay, this should be a small I. Very small I. My private message request. Request private message request. Okay. All right. So now if we submit our users, so now user is joining the room lobby. So the room list is updated. The user list is updated. And if I press send when I haven't typed anything, nothing happens. If I type the text, it's going to send my message as public. And if I type and press send, it's going to send my message as private. However, the message is not being sent because I haven't completed my message event handlers, the private message event and the public message handlers. I created a request, but I haven't written the handlers, which we'll be doing next. But before we do that, notice that when I click the send, the message is not erased, the old message, and also the focus is not going to be put back into my text field. So what I need to do here is that after I send the messages, which I do send them, just the sending functionality is not working yet. So I create the message text and I empty it out, and then I go and put my focus of my field or my user interface into the message function. So now if I run this text and I submit a username, and then if I click things, see the message is going to be created, and sent. Now if I click on a user, I would want to add this function, this name of this user as a private message here, and then I just write the text and send the message. So now let's go and create the public message functionality when you type something for your message to be sent. So to do that, we will go up here and notice that we have a public message event here that will be called when a user sends a public message, which is down here when your user sends a public message. So we need to call up and essentially write up the functionality for my public message event. And the public message event handler is up here. So now when a user sends a message publicly, the public message event handler is going to be called. Now, notice, let me show you this window one more time. Okay, so this is now my my window. And so what happens here when the user sends a message, I want to show the message up here. And remember from the UI elements, this field was called history. So all I need to do at this point is just to add the message to the end of this the history. So what I will do is that I will create a string and I call it sent message, which would be a string object. And this would essentially be the username who sent that message. So I get the username. And then I add a colon to this text. And then get message. And then I add a backslash n to it. And now that I have created this, I add, or I basically append text to my history object, which is a text box. So for this, I would basically append the sent message. Okay, so this should take care of my public message sending. Okay, so. So if I type a text, as you see, it says that Ali, which is my username, colon, space, said that message. And it keeps appending that text at the end. And as these texts get bigger, it would basically create a scroll bar for my text. Now, to implement the private message sending, I would have to make sure that I can send this message privately. So there are two functions, two things that I need to add. One is the ability to select a user and send a message to them privately. And two is the sending of the message privately. So let's take care of the second functionality here. We have already the private message event created for us here. So what we need to do at this point is to basically append and update the history value saying that somebody had privately said something to you. So for this, we will go essentially and in our private message event and create a string, and I call this another sent message, which would be a string, and this string will be essentially the private keyword that I want to show. So and I'll just write it as private. So somebody, actually, let's call this whisper. And event dot get username plus a colon space plus e dot get message plus a new line. So basically what it does is that I create a string, and this string I call it just sent message, and it says whisper, and the name of the user who's whispering, colon, and the text of the message that they whispered. And then we update or append the history with this sent message string. Okay, let's test this functionality. So now the user is selected, and so if I type my text just like this, it sends it publicly. Now if I want to send it to Ali, so I do a forward slash, the name of the user, a colon, and then a space, and then the message, and when I send it, it thinks that it's a private message because I started with a backslash and the name of the user, followed by a colon. So the username that is the recipient is going to be the characters between the forward slash and the colon. And the message is going to be the all of the characters after the colon. So whatever we're typing is going to be typed. So this is really a good way to start. However, notice that I could have created a username that's not valid. And so my chat functionality would not have been able to send the correct text to the correct user because that username was not in the list. It would be awfully nice if I could click on the name of a user from the list and then it would automatically create a private message text for me, which means that I want to create a functionality when I clicked on the username from this list for it to automatically put a forward slash, the name of the user that I clicked, and a colon, and so that I could type my message into the text field. And we can establish that functionality next. So to do this, remember that we created a under our UI elements. Actually, let me just minimize these functions that I already created and I don't need anymore. The refresh zone, the refresh user list, the private message that I'm sending, and a public message event that I'm sending. And then also, I would go up here and I click my send, I minimize my send item. And so now I'm getting very close to finishing this project. So I need to open up this build UI elements to just show you something else. So here, notice that we created four event handlers, one for the send button and one for the room button, room create button. We also created an event handler for the selection of a user from a user list, which is called on user selected. And notice here at the bottom here, I have the function that is called when a user is selected. So all I need to do is to grab the name of that user from the list and then create a private message, which is basically is the syntax to message entry with a field entry field with a colon. So to do this functionality, we will go up here and let me just clear some of these texts. All right, so we go and first of all, we make sure that the user list is not empty. So we need to check to see if the user list selected item is not null, which means that if a user has been in fact selected, then the idea is to go ahead and create a variable, and I call it, let's call it selected user, selected username, which is a string, actually a user item, and this will come from my user list dot selected item dot data as a user. Okay, and this is important. If we declare it as a string, then we will not be able to get the username of that object. So we look at the user list, we look at the selected item and the data that's contained in the item, and then we cast it as a user so that it could read the username and any other areas that we need. For example, if we wanted to find which room they were in and which zone they were in, we could do that next. So next, we just create the text of our message from the message field, and essentially that would be a forward slash plus the selected user, selected username dot get username plus a colon and a space. Okay, so now if a user clicks on the name of a user, the message text automatically will have a forward slash, the name of the user, and a colon. So this way it will help us to select our users easier. I probably have made another mistake, another syntax error, which is here, selected item. So now let's compile. Okay, now we type the username. Now the username is created, and now if the user clicks on the name of a user, the message automatically creates forward slash ali colon, and then whatever message you type in and you send is going to be privately sent. So it has the whisper keyword and then the text. And if you just go ahead and send a message, the public message will be sent. Alright, so we are almost done with the functionalities of this program. And I think the one final thing that's left for this process to do is for us to be able to create a room by typing the name of a room in the Create Room button. And then when the room is created, which already is, to associate users in that room. Let me just go over the onCreate Room functionality, and I already left this for you so that you could essentially take a look at it and see how it works. And I don't expect you to write these parts of the program here. So let me close the private user selection. So here we have the functionality for creating a room when the create room is clicked. So when the create room is clicked, which is this function here, you would create a new screen, and in that screen you basically create an on room submit button. And when the room submit button is pressed, you basically join the room that you just created. However, let's go ahead and create the functionality for our users to be able to join these new rooms. Let me just go ahead and create a new room here. So when I create a new room, the user that created it automatically will join that room. And when a new user joins, the new user will see the lobby and the new room. So I want to create the functionality so that the user could choose a room, either lobby or the new room, and when they click on it, to go and automatically join that room. Setting up this functionality is fairly straightforward. So now that we have the room created with clicking on the room creation, we will need to go ahead and populate the functionality within room selected. Remember, with the user selected, I had the list of the users, and when the user clicks on the username, I create a private message syntax. With the rooms, well, all we need to do is just join that room. So we go and we see if a user selects a new room. If the room selection is not null, which means that there's a room in that list, we create a variable. And let's call this variable selected room, which will be of the type room. And this would contain the room list dot selected item dot data as a room. And then we'll join that room. So we see if that selected room was not empty or null, and it was not the room that the user is currently in, then we join the selected room dot get room name, and we'll be able to join that room. So let's test. So if a user comes in, they will be placed in the lobby, and they can create a new room. And when they create a new room, they automatically join the new room. And as you see, the room list is refreshed for them. The user list of the users in that room is refreshed, and the text, the label of the rooms associated with it. Now, when a new user logs in, let's see, John logs in. Now, John is the user, and they see two rooms, the lobby room, which they're already at, and the alley's room. So if they click on the lobby's room, they're already in that room. So the user room selection will not be null. The room name is associated, but that is the room that they're currently at, which is this underscore room here. So they will not rejoin that room. Otherwise, if the user now clicks on alley's room, as you see here, the room is a different room, so they go and join the room, alley's room. And remember from the join room, they leave room first and enter Ali's room. So now that both of these users are in Ali's room. Okay, now let's create a third user here. And so the third user comes in. And Mary now joins. Now when Mary joins, they see Ali's room, lobby, and they're the only person in the lobby, Mary. And as you see here, John and Ali both are in John and Ali are both in Ali's room, and Mary is in the lobby. So Mary can join Ali's room. Now Mary, Ali, and John all are in the Ali's room. So let's say that Mary wants to create a another room. Let's call it office. So now everybody would see Ali's room, office, and basically Ali and John are still in Ali's room. So John is still in Ali's room, Ali is still in Ali's room, and Mary now is in the office. So now, for example here, John could join the office. So John will go into the office, and then also Ali could join the office. And when the Ali's room is empty, the Electro server automatically empties that room. We could associate the property of the room that would be persistent, so it would still be active even if any users are not in that room. But what we did with our own rooms here, we associated all of the users basically. All of the rooms as non-persistent rooms. So when all of the users leave that room, the room will be essentially empty. And as you see here, when a new user, for example, Bob, joins, they would be placed in the lobby. And so Bob will see office and lobby, and all of the other players are in the office. So in this case, now since we already have the office created, we could let's say that, for example, John could now go to lobby. So now Bob and John are in the lobby, and Mary and Ali are in the office. So for example, in this case, Mary can go to the lobby, and Ali is the only person in the office. So this is a simple chat example, and I hope that you enjoyed this example and that you go ahead and work with it and create this chat example and test it and see how things work. So, and as you see, as players leave, when a room is empty, that room will be destroyed. So this finishes our chat example, and so I will create the assignment for the chat room so that you could go ahead and write the program for the chat room and test it out, and then submit that as an assignment. With this, I think the chat room unit should be quite clear, and I will talk to you next time with looking at how decisions are made in a client-server architecture for same networks. Thank you very much. Enjoy the chat room.